My talk is about virtual audiovisual environments for hearing aid evaluation and fitting. During my PhD project in Oldenburg, I helped to develop these virtual environments that are shown here in order to investigate the self-motion of people when listening to in everyday life situations. If you're interested in hearing also the acoustics, you can follow this link to some videos on YouTube. So we modeled the following situations: the living room, where the news was shown on the TV, a lecture hall, where there was a lecture, cafeteria environment, where there was a multi-talker conversation of people sitting around the table, a train station, where there were announcements over a loudspeaker system, a street environment where there was also a multi-talker conversation at a bus stop, and finally a street situation where we measured passive listening of participants standing at an intersection and they were just told to wait there for someone to arrive. This is how it looked like in the lab. So of course, the acoustic environment was presented over many loudspeakers. The visual environment was projected on a cylindrical screen. And we measured the self-motion of the participants while listening to the virtual environments with head tracker and EUG electrodes. So when developing the virtual environments, we showed first that visual cues are important for self-motion. We compared a condition with videos of real persons to conditions with animated characters, as shown here. And typical self-motion in such an environment with multi-talker conversation, for example, in the cafeteria, looks like this. So plotted here is the horizontal gaze angle of the direction the participants were looking at over time. We see the gray, thin gray lines represent the individual data of the participants. As you can see, there is quite a bit of variance between participants. But on average, they follow the location of the active speaker, which is plotted in green. They follow this quite accurately. So this was a condition in the cafeteria with virtual characters. And if we look at the error between the direction the participants were looking at and the actual position of the active speaker, we see that for the video condition and condition with animated characters that had some kind of lip movement, this is pretty much the same. So here they look about as accurately at the active speaker. However, for the audio-only condition, the error is much larger. So here, they don't really follow the active speaker anymore, but mostly they're just looking straight ahead. If the animated characters were not moving their mouth, then the error was also larger. So we've shown here that visual cues can influence the self-motion, and also that they can steer the spatial attention, in this case towards the direction of the active speaker. We've also shown that self-motion can influence the performance of directional hearing aid algorithms by estimating the broadband SNR benefit that different algorithms would have provided in these virtual environments under the self-motion of the different participants. And this is plotted here. So here we see pretty large range, and this is the range over the different self-motion trajectories of the participants. So if the participants were moving their head in one way or the other, this could have an up to 6 dB difference in broadband SNR benefit of directional algorithms, and this is averaged over the entire duration of the virtual environment. So if we would look at individual time points, then this effect would be even larger. We also looked at the self-motion of hearing-impaired listeners, and we found some interesting differences with normal hearing participants in the amount of movement that was done with the head and the eyes. So when looking at a certain direction, people typically do part of the movement with their head and part of the movement with their eyes, so they don't turn their head all the way. For the young non-hearing participants, they did about 46% of the movement with their head. On average, the older normal hearing participants did significantly more of the movement with the head, namely 57%. And for the hearing impaired participants, this was even larger. So they did almost all of the movement with their head, and about 93%. However, we did not see a difference in hearing impaired participants who had their hearing loss compensated and were listening to output of an adaptive differential microphone. So the adaptive differential microphone did had no effect on the self-motion of the participants. However, we have to note here that the adaptive differential microphone has quite low directivity, and also the benefit it provided in virtual environments was quite low. So for algorithms with a higher directivity, we do expect them to have an effect on the self-motion. So we showed that with the developed methods, we can assess listening behavior in more ecologically valid conditions in the lab by adding visual cues, increasing the acoustic complexity, and including head movement. So this can at least partly explain the difference in benefits that was found and reported in literature between standard lab situations and real life. Then we have also found some points of improvement when developing these virtual environments. So for validation, we checked if the environments would be realistic enough to allow participants to imagine being in the real environment. So we did this with a presence questionnaire, and the participants reported that at least to some extent they had a sense of being there in the virtual environment. And also the realism of the audio was judged pretty good by the participants. However, for the video realism, they said this was somewhat unrealistic. Then we, in the interview, we asked specifically which points they thought were unrealistic. And they mentioned that objects, especially the close objects, looked unrealistic. This is probably because of the shading in the virtual environment. They mentioned that in the cafeteria, the persons were mumbling and they wouldn't talk like that in noise. This is known as the Lombard effect, that usually in the presence of noise, people increase their vocal effort. However, the conversation recordings were done in quiet, and this caused a bit of mismatch. So even though the SNR was realistic, it was still a bit too unintelligible. So this would have to be improved in when changing the virtual environment. They also mentioned that they cannot lip read. This was because the lip syncing model was a pretty simple model that also worked in real time. And currently there's work being done to improve this in Oldenburg, a PhD project of Jürgen Otten, and I'm sure that more institutions are looking into this. They also mentioned something about interaction, that for example, in the cafeteria environment, they normally would just ask the persons to speak up. Of course, this was not possible here. But it's also shown in literature that interaction can also affect the self-motion. So this would also be an important factor for improvement. Finally, we did not do yet a comparison with real life situations, but this is currently going on in Oldenburg. Yeah, so far the work I've been doing in my PhD project, currently I just started in at the Erasmus Medical Center in Rotterdam with the Marie Curie Fellowship. And in this project, I am looking at improving the hearing device fitting with virtual reality. So I'm investigating if we can use the virtual environments in the clinic for the fitting of hearing devices. So the problem that I'm looking into is that the current fine-tuning process is based on trial and error. The audiologists make some changes in the settings of the hearing devices, and then the patient has to go home and try out these different settings. And this is, of course, pretty time-consuming. But with virtual reality, new settings of hearing aids and cochlear implants could be tested right away in relevant everyday life situations in the clinic. And by using the pairwise comparisons for the fine-tuning, the settings could then be better adjusted. So as I said, I'm doing this project at the Erasmus Medical Center in Rotterdam with André Goedegeburen, and also the University of Oldenburg is involved as a collaboration partner with Volker Hohmann and Liesel Krim. So what do we have to do to implement these virtual environments in the clinic? First of all, we have to present them using VR glasses and a loudspeaker array. So first, this makes it not much more portable. We cannot set up such a big cylindrical screen in a clinical environment. And loudspeakers are still needed because we are presenting it to people with hearing devices. So in order to do this, we also have to switch to a different game engine. But the good thing about this is that this also improves the shading of the virtual environment, which could help to make it more realistic. Another important point is the communication between the patient and the audiologist. This should be possible while being in the virtual environments, because you cannot just take off the VR glasses all the time. That would be pretty annoying. And yeah, this would of course also add some interaction to the virtual environment, which is could help for the realism. Another important point is that we have to reconsider the selection of relevant situations. So Carolina Smeets and co-authors have this publication on which listening situations occur in the daily life of hearing impaired persons. And they show that not only speech perception is important, so speech perception is here, speech communication is about 31% of the cases. But there is also focused listening situations, which is partly speech but can also be music, and non-specific listening situations, which is monitoring of the environment or passive listening. And we also did a survey with patients where they had to indicate in which listening situations they want to improve their hearing. And yeah, of course, the speech situations are mentioned most, but they also mention non-speech situations, for example, listening to music. Also, participating in traffic is mentioned quite a lot, and monitoring the environment so that they know what's going on around them. So these are important situations to include also in the fitting process. And finally, there are more and more hearing aids and also cochlear implants with automatic recognition of listening situations and the selection of the corresponding programs. Of course, if we are fine-tuning the hearing devices, we should fine-tune each program in the corresponding situation it was intended for. In order to do this, I will ask hearing aid manufacturers for more information on these programs and which situations they were intended for. So if you're listening, please come in contact with me. Then, of course, we also want to evaluate this, if the virtual reality really adds something to the clinical practice. We think that it could make the fine-tuning process faster because we can reduce these periods of trying out settings at home. We can increase the patient involvement, which hopefully also makes them more satisfied, both with the fine-tuning process and with the hearing devices. And we hope the hearing devices will function better. And in order to test this, we also need more ecologically valid evaluation methods, which is a challenge for this project. So this is what are we working on for the next 2 years, and I hope that next time I can report some progress on this project. Thank you for your attention.